Hi, I'm Jean-Marc Prieur, a program manager on the Microsoft Identity team. In this video, I'm going to show you the code related to authentication in an ASP.NET Core 2.0 web API that accepts tokens for users signed in with Azure Active Directory using their work or school account or their Microsoft personal account. I'll also show you how a client application uses the Microsoft Authentication Library for .NET, MSAL.NET in short, in order to acquire a token to access this protected API. I'm assuming here that you are familiar with the notion of Azure Active Directory tenant and understand .NET Core 2.0 web applications, web APIs. So, what's the agenda? After a quick intro showing the topology of the samples, I'm going to briefly demo the scenario. Then I'll show you the code that protects the web API, and then the code in the client application to acquire a token for the web API. Finally, I'll share some resources with next steps, including a link to the sample used in the video and other samples, which will help you go further, for instance, to call the Microsoft Graph from your web API. The Azure Active Directory endpoint lets you sign in users with either work or school accounts or Microsoft personal accounts, formerly live accounts. New this year, you can now use the Azure Active Directory V2 endpoint to protect your own web API and get a token for your own web API. The diagram behind shows the topology of the sample we'll use in the demo and to understand the code that acquires the token from Azure Active Directory using an interactive flow. And then from there, it will call the ASP.NET 2 web API, which maintains a per-user list of items, which you can see on the picture here. So what code does the magic? Let's start by demoing the scenario, and we'll see the code. So here, I've opened the sample in Visual Studio, and as expected from the topology diagram, there is a service, the web API, and a client. So let me run them so that we understand and then map the experience to the code. I'm running the service, nothing happens, that's a service which returns JSON, nothing to see, and by the way, here we are not authenticated, so it won't give us anything. So I run this service and I'm already signed in. So I'll sign out and show you the experience, the sign-in experience. What you will have is to go through this dialog, which is provided by Azure Active Directory, and use the user you want to use. So in that case, I just need to provide the password. Click the sign in button and we are back in the application. This pop-up disappears if you want, and I can start entering, entering a certain number of items. And this list is maintained really by the service for me, for the user, do shopping, do laundry. And what I want to show you as well is that if I run a second instance of this application, then, so let me run it as well. I will have now two instances of this application, this one on top of the other, and they share the same list. And by the way, this one has signed me in automatically because there is a cache and they share the token cache. The token being what is passed to authenticate me in the web API. So let's go to the code. Let's understand what does the magic. Let's start by the service. So when my application will call the service, it will call it into a controller, an ASP.NET 2 controller, and this controller will require authentication because of this attribute, authorize attribute. And here the code of this thing is very simple, the two methods to get the list and to post an element in the list. This is very simple, it uses basically a list, a concurrent list, and it finds from the security token, from the user which is authenticated in the client, it finds the owner, and then it filters the items for this owner and the contrary here. So that's how you enter in the application. Now, how is it that authorize does this magic? This is because the program, the ASP.NET Core program, starts by calling this startup class, And this startup class has two interesting sections. The first is this one, which is use authentication. So we will use authentication. And here, this configure service will say, we use authentication, that's a web API, and therefore we'll use JWT, meaning JSON Web Token, bearer tokens, to do the authentication. That means that the API will need to be called with a header, an HTTP header, containing authorization, and then bearer, and then a token provided by Azure Directory. And this web API will check that the token is valid for itself, and it does it with this code. So there is a bit of configuration that is specifying that in the app settings, which is a configuration file, there is a section named Azure AD, and the content of these sections will go into options, which are here. Client ID, client secrets is not needed for just a web API, and we'll see how that maps to the configuration file and the application registration. So I will, to show you how that maps, I've opened here the appsettings.json, which is the configuration file, and I'm going to jump to the configuration of my web application. And you see that my web application has an application ID, which unsurprisingly, you find here as the client ID of the application. Then there is a domain, so that's the domain of here my company, and the tenant ID is something which is for your Active Directory, which you know, and that's for the configuration, and it also needs to know what will be the URL, the enable URL. So in terms of platform, we have here a web API, and you'll find the scopes which other applications can call. So let me put that a bit bigger, and you see that this web API will be accessible by others in terms of as a resource and to do something particular, and that's what is the scope on the form API, the client ID, and then access as a user. So that's for the code of the service. Let me remove that and have Visual Studio full screen. So now, how do we call this web API? You've seen all the code the code that matters for the web API. Now, in the client, how do we call this code? So in the same way we had some configuration in the service, we also have some configuration in the client. The client is another application which has a client ID, but what I want to show you in particular is this to-do list scope, the scope of what we are going to do, to call, and this is exactly what I mentioned, API, the GUID, the client ID of my service, and then access as a user. So my client accesses the web API in the name of the user, for the user. And then, how do we do that? So there will be two steps. The first is acquire a token, and the second is call the web API with a bearer token. So how do we get a token? We use MSAL, Microsoft Authentication Libraries, and in this case, we have a desktop application, so it's a public client application. You recognize the configuration which was in the config file. You see the action of the token cache, which I mentioned when I instantiated two instances of this application. And from this app, we will get a token. We will get a token by this pattern, which is first try to get it from the cache by calling acquire token silent. And then if that doesn't succeed, in this case of this application, we decide to show the sign-in button, sign-in first, and then enable the sign-in button. So how do we get this token if it's not really in the cache? Then we'll go in this method named sign-in. I will find the sign-in method. And in this sign-in method, I will this time do an acquire token async, which is interactive. And by the way, I will force the application to show the select account dialog. So that's why you could see that I could choose between several identities. Then the last part is how do I call the API? So calling the API is done in the same code as here. So when you get What you get from acquired token, silent async, or acquired token is an authentication result, as you see here. And authentication results has a certain number of members, including one which is the access token. And by this line, I'm creating an authentication, an authorization header with the value bearer and the access token. And I will add that to the HTTP client, and then I can call my API, which is the base address you've seen, and plus API to-do list, that's classical .NET core web API, and that's it. That's the way you provide the authentication of the user to the web API. So what did we see? We've seen that a web API can accept bearer tokens and verify that they are for it. And then we've seen how a client application can use this bearer token. The last thing I want to show you is here in this code, this is tenanted. We have done it for a specific tenant, that's a line of business application. If you just change that, then now you accept any identity, so and then you will also have to do that because that's not specific to a tenant. And of course, you would probably want to do a bit more, which is implement the issuer validator, which is a delegate. So I'm not going to do it, but I'm just giving you some leads on how you would do it. That's it. So that's it for the demo. I hope you found it useful. We've explored the most important part of the code to protect a V2 web API. We've also seen the code in a WPF client to acquire a token and call this web API. We've seen that both applications need to be registered with Azure Active Directory V2 endpoint, and we've seen the code to configure them accordingly. To conclude, here are some resources you can follow to find information. I encourage you to go for the sample yourselves and learn how to recreate it. I've also included samples which will take you from this point to calling the Microsoft Graph, a link to our documentation, and a link on how to get help, ask questions, or post suggestions. Thanks for watching!